The Book of Disquiet by Fernando Pessoa, Section 124. Chapter on Indifference, or something like that. Every soul worthy of itself desires to live life in the extreme. To be satisfied with what one is given is for slaves. To ask for more is for children. To conquer more is for madmen. Because every conquest is. To live life in the extreme means to live it to the limit, but there are three ways of doing this, and it's up to the superior soul to choose one of the ways. The first way to live life in the extreme is by possessing it to an extreme degree, via a Ulyssean journey through all experiential sensations, through all forms of externalized energy. Few people, however, in all the ages of the world have been able to shut their eyes with a fatigue that's the sum of all fatigues, having possessed everything in every way. Indeed, few can get life to yield to them completely, body and soul, making them so sure of its love that jealous thoughts become impossible. But this must surely be the desire of every superior, strong-willed soul. When this soul, however, realizes that it can never accomplish such a feat, that it lacks the strength to conquer all parts of the whole, then there are two other roads it can follow. One is total renunciation, formal and complete abstention, whereby it transfers to the sensible sphere whatever cannot be wholly possessed in the sphere of activity and energy. Better to supremely not than to act spottily, inadequately, and in vain, like the superfluous, inane vast majority of men. The other road is that of perfect equilibrium, the search for the limit in absolute proportion, whereby the longing for the extreme passes from the will and emotion to the intelligence, one's entire ambition being not to live all life, or to feel all life, but to organize all life, to consummate it in intelligent harmony and coordination. The longing to understand, which in noble souls often replaces the longing to act, belongs to the sphere of sensibility. To replace energy with the intelligence, to break the link between will and emotion, stripping the material life's gestures of any and all interest, this is achieved, is worth more than life, which is so hard to possess in its entirety and so sad when possessed only in part. The Argonaut said that it wasn't necessary to live, only to sail. We Argonauts of our pathological sensibility say that it's not necessary to live, only to feel. Section 125. Your ships, Lord, did not make a greater voyage than the one made by my thought in the disaster of this book. They rounded no cape and sighted no far-flung beach beyond what daring men had dared and what minds had dreamed, to equal the capes I rounded with my imagination and the beaches where I landed with my... Thanks to your initiative, Lord, the real world was discovered. The intellectual world will be discovered thanks to mine. Your Argonauts grappled with monsters and fears. In the voyage of my thought, I also had monsters and fears to contend with. On the path to the abstract chasm that lies in the depths of things, there are horrors that the world's men don't imagine, and fears to endure that human experience doesn't know. The cape of common sea beyond which all is mystery is perhaps more human than the abstract path to the world's void. Separated from their native soil, banished from the path leading back to their homes, forever widowed from the tranquility of life being the same, your emissaries finally arrived, when you were already dead, at the oceanic end of the earth. They saw, materially, a new sky, a new earth. I, far away from the paths to myself, blind to the vision of the life I love, I too have finally arrived at the vacant end of things, at the imponderable edge of creation's limit, at the port in no place of the world's abstract chasm. I have entered, Lord, that port. I have wandered, Lord, over that sea. I have gazed, Lord, at that invisible chasm. I dedicate this work of supreme discovery to the memory of your Portuguese name, Creator of Argonauts. Section 126. I have times of great stagnation. It's not, as happens to everyone, that I let days and days go by without sending a postcard in response to the urgent letter I received. It's not, as happens to no one, that I definitely postpone what's easy and would be useful, or what's useful and would be pleasurable. There's more subtlety in my self-contradiction. I stagnate in my very soul. My will, emotions, and thoughts stop functioning, and this suspension lasts for days on end. Only the vegetative life of my soul, words, gestures, habits, expresses me to others, and through them, to myself. In these periods of shadowy subsistence, I'm unable to think, feel, or want. I can't write more than numbers and scribbles. I don't feel, and the death of a loved one would strike me as having happened in a foreign language. I'm helpless. It's as if I were sleeping and my gestures, words, and deliberate acts were no more than a peripheral respiration, the rhythmic instinct of some organism. Thus, the days keep passing, and if I added them all up, who knows how much of my life they would amount to? It sometimes occurs to me, when I shake off this state of suspension, that perhaps I'm not as naked as I suppose, that perhaps there are still intangible clothes covering the eternal absence of my true soul. It occurs to me that thinking, feeling, and wanting can also be stagnations, on the threshold of a more intimate thinking, a feeling that's more mine, a will lost somewhere in the labyrinth of who I really am. However, it may be, I'll let it be, and to whatever god or gods that be, I'll let go of who I am, according as luck and chance determine, faithful to a forgotten pledge. Section 127. I don't get indignant, because indignation is for the strong. I'm not resigned, because resignation is for the noble. I don't hold my peace because silence is for the great. I am neither strong, nor noble, nor great. I suffer and I dream. I complain because I'm weak, and since I'm an artist, I amuse myself by making my complaints musical and by arranging my dreams according to my idea of what makes them beautiful. I only regret not being a child, since then I could believe in my dreams. And not being a madman, since then I could keep everyone around me from getting close to my soul. Taking dreams for reality, living too intensely what I dream, has given this thorn to the false rose of my dreamed life, that not even dreams cheer me, because I see their defects. Not even by colorfully painting my window can I block out the noise of the life outside, which doesn't know I'm observing it. Happy the creators of pessimistic systems. Besides taking refuge in the fact of having made something, they can exult in their explanation of universal suffering and include themselves in it. I don't complain about the world. I don't protest in the name of the universe. I'm not a pessimist. I suffer and complain, but I don't know if suffering is the norm, nor do I know if it's human to suffer. Why should I care to know? I suffer without knowing if I deserve to. A hunted doe. I'm not a pessimist. I'm sad. Section 128. I've always rejected being understood. To be understood is to prostitute oneself. I prefer to be taken seriously for what I'm not. Remaining humanly unknown with naturalness and all due respect. Nothing would bother me more than if they found me strange at the office. I like to revel in the irony that they don't find me at all strange. I like the hair shirt of being regarded by them as their equal. I like the crucifixion of being considered no different. There are martyrdoms more subtle than those recorded for the saints and hermits. There are torments of our mental awareness, as there are of the body and of desire, and the former as in the latter. There is a certain sensuality. Section 129. The office boy was tying up the day's packages in the twilight coolness of the empty office.
"What a thunderclap," the cruel bandit said to no one, in the loud voice of a good morning.
My heart started beating again. The apocalypse had passed. There was a respite. And with what relief, a flashing light, a pause, the hard clap, did this now near, then retreating thunder relieve us of what had been. God had ceased. My lungs breathed heavily. I realized it was stuffy in the office. I noticed that there were other people besides the office boy. They had all been silent. I heard something crisp and tremulous. It was one of the ledger's large and heavy pages that Moireira, checking something, had abruptly turned. Section 130. I often wonder what I would be like if shielded from the winds of fate by the screen of wealth. I'd never been brought up by the dutiful hand of my uncle to an office in Lisbon, nor risen from it to other offices, all the way up to this paltry pinnacle as a competent assistant bookkeeper, with a job that's like a siesta and a salary I can live on. I realize that if I'd had this imagined past, I wouldn't now be able to write these pages, which are at least something, and therefore better than all the pages I would only have dreamed of writing in better circumstances. For banality is a form of intelligence. And reality, especially if stupid or crude, is a natural complement of the soul. My job as a bookkeeper is responsible for a large part of what I'm able to feel and think, since this occurs as a denial and evasion of that self-same job. If I had to list, in the blank space of a questionnaire, the main literary influences on my intellectual development, I would immediately jot down the name of Cesario Verde, but I would also write in the names of Senor Vasquez, my boss, of Moira, the head bookkeeper, of Viera, the local sales representative, and of Antonio, the office boy. And as the crucial address of them all, I would write Lisbon in big letters. The fact is that not only Cesario Verde, but also my co-workers have served as a correction, coefficients for my vision of the world. I think that's the term, whose exact meaning I obviously don't know, for the treatment given by engineers to mathematics so that it can be applied to life. If it is the right term, then that's what I mean. If it isn't, then let's imagine it could be, the intention substituting for the failed metaphor. And if I think with all the lucidity I can muster about what my life has apparently been, I see it as a colored thing, a chocolate wrapper or a cigar band swept from the dirty tablecloth by the brisk brush of the housemaid who's listening overheard, and landing in the dustpan with the crumbs and the crusts of reality proper. It stands out from other things with a similar destiny by its privilege of getting to ride in the dustpan as well. And above the maid's brushing, the gods continue their conversation, indifferent to the affairs of the world's servants. Yes, if I'd been wealthy, shielded, spruce, ornamental, I wouldn't have been this brief episode of pretty paper among crumbs. I would have remained on a lucky dish.
Thank you, but no.
And I've retreated to the sideboard to grow old. This way, rejected after my useful substance has been eaten, I go to the rubbish bin with the dust of what's left of Christ's body. And I can't imagine what will follow and among what stars, but something inevitably will follow.